have a wedding proposal. Of all the proposals I've heard about, and I've heard about a lot of proposals, sometimes when we're with folks, we would say, tell us how you met, tell us about your proposal, your engagement, or we hear them just from other people, whether we want to hear them or not. But of all the proposals that I've heard, none are like this one in Ruth chapter 3. I would venture a guess that no matter how creative some of the proposals that you know about, or maybe your proposal, I will say that no one in this sanctuary has ever come up with a plan like Naomi came up with a plan for Ruth and this proposal between Ruth and Boaz. Well, as the story went on, and as Ruth went out to the fields, and as she would come back with her barley and her food, the wheels began to turn in Naomi's mind about a kinsman redeemer or a near relative for Ruth. There was a custom in Israel. It was called the custom of levirate marriage, or levirate marriage, which said that the brother of the husband who died childless would marry the widow. So in other words, the widow's brother-in-law would marry her, so the deceased would have an heir if there were no children before he died. But the problem is Ruth's brother-in-law, Kilian, was dead. He was not living along with her husband, Mahlon. So there was no brother. And the responsibility then was passed on to the nearest relative. Okay? So we come to verse 1 of chapter 3, and we see here that Naomi is saying to Ruth, my daughter, it's time that I found a permanent home for you, meaning it's time that I find you a husband. Things were done a little differently in those days, but sometimes things are done that way today. In this case, not the mother, but the mother-in-law. You know, it's time we find you a husband. We read in verse 20 of chapter 2 that Naomi knew about the relationship with Boaz and herself. Verse 20 of chapter 2 says, the Lord bless him. This is when Naomi came back with all this grain. Said, he is showing his kindness to us as well as to your husband. That man is one of our closest relatives. He's one of our family redeemers. So she knew about this relationship that she had in as far as kinsmanship with Boaz. And his earlier kindness to Ruth kind of sounded the knock of opportunity at these two widows' doors. And Naomi is opening the door of this opportunity now without any hesitation. So she began to know that Boaz was going to be the answer to her own prayer for Ruth and for Orpah as well. If you recall back in chapter 1, she said, may the Lord bless you with the security of another marriage. And Orpah went back home to find that. And Ruth said, no, I'm following you regardless of whether there's marriage or not. But now her prayer is beginning to be answered. And in verse 2, Naomi is coming up with a plan. She says that Boaz is a close relative of ours. She said he's been very kind to Ruth and to Naomi by letting her gather grain with the young women. And she says tonight he's going to be at the threshing floor, the winnowing floor. And so she said, here's the plan. You're going to go out there after he has had some food and some drink, and you're going to go to the place where he is going to be winnowing grain. And so it's going to be under the cover of night and darkness. And maybe that's because it would be away from itching ears and gossipy tongues, that people wouldn't see Ruth and Boaz talking to one another. So in verse 3, Naomi is calculating her plan. She's articulating her plan. She says to Ruth, clean up and dress up. I think she said something like, do as I tell you. And by the way, Ruth did as she was told, which is different than in chapter 1 when Naomi was telling Ruth to go back to her home. simply because his feet were cold. I do that at night if my feet get out from under the covers. I wake up and my feet are cold. And by the way, a little tongue-in-cheek here, it wouldn't be the last groom to get cold feet either. But he woke up suddenly. He was surprised. He made this surprising discovery that suddenly cleared away his drowsiness. It says here that he was fully awake. Now, this upright and this honorable Israelite found himself feet to face with an unknown woman in a secluded part of the threshing floor. And Boaz is thinking, uh-oh, this is not good. Boaz was has his feet uncovered, and a lady is lying at his feet. Well, verse 9 takes on a little more of detail here. He says, "Who are you?" And she says, "Well, I'm your servant Ruth. Spread the corner of your covering, spread the corner of your blanket over me, for you are my family redeemer." Well, here's an interesting part of the proposal. Boaz did not propose to Ruth. Ruth proposed to Boaz. When she said that he was to spread the corner of his garment over her, that was a way in those days of asking Boaz to marry her. Anybody have that proposal story in your background? Or in your friends or family? I don't think so. Boaz knew exactly what she was asking. And he knew that she was asking him to marry her. The word corner there can be translated wing. Spread your wings over me. We won't take time to go back into chapter 2, verse 12, and actually read the verse, but there's a reference there to Boaz when he said that hopefully the Lord would spread his wings over Ruth. She's really asking him to spread his wings over her, and that she would be under the protective wings of Boaz. What a beautiful picture of marriage, the protective wings of the husband. Well, we're going to jump down to verses 12 and 13, because just as it seemed that the wedding bells would be ringing, and it was time for the question, "If anyone knows why these two shouldn't be joined in marriage, speak now or forever, hold your peace." We come to verses 12 and 13, and we read these words. Boaz is saying, "Now, while it's true that I am one of your family redeemers, there's another man who is more closely related than I am to Naomi." He says, "Stay here tonight, and in the morning I will talk to him. And if he's willing to redeem you, if he's willing to basically marry you, very well, then let him do that," he said. "But if he's not willing, then as surely as the Lord lives, I will redeem you myself. Now lie down here until morning." And there was nothing going on that shouldn't have been going on here. This was very proper. Boaz was an upright and an honest man of integrity. But he's saying, "You need to stay here till morning, or at least till dawn, so you can find your way back home." But just at the moment that we thought everything was going to be fine, he brings up a condition, and in a display of his integrity, he says, "There's another person that's a closer relative. integrity and his honesty, he says, we have to do this the right way. Now, a little item here, kind of a parenthetical item in verse 15. Boaz said to her as she was going to go home, bring your cloak and spread it out. And he measured 6 scoops of barley into the cloak. So that he's giving her more barley to take home. And now it's barley that has been threshed, and she's getting just the grain of the barley to take home. And he placed it on her back, and then he and she also returned to town. He gave her enough barley for about 2 weeks at this point. This is kind of what the figure of speech would have imagined for about 2 weeks. Well, we come to verses 16 and 17. You can see them there for yourself. Naomi was waiting basically at the front door when Ruth came home in the morning. She was probably pacing the floor all night. And as soon as Ruth got into the front door, Naomi says, "What happened?" And literally that means, "Who are you?" She knew who Ruth was. It wasn't like, who are you? I don't recognize you. Basically, when she says, "Who are you?" She's asking, "Are you still Ruth the Moabitess, or are you the soon-to-be Boaz, the wife of Boaz?" That's what she meant with, "Who are you? Are you engaged or are you not engaged?" And basically, Ruth said, "Yes, I'm engaged. I just don't know to whom." How ironic. Naomi had complained that she had come home empty without any helpers, and now she has one too many. There are 2 kinsmen redeemers in her life. And then Ruth showed Naomi Boaz's generous gift of grain again. And by the way, Warren Wiersbe, many of you know who Warren Wiersbe is, he says this about Boaz giving barley to Ruth to take home after the engagement, the proposal, I should say. And Warren Wiersbe says, "A man who sends a generous gift to his prospective mother-in-law is certainly a good choice for a husband." So, young men, remember that. Well, these are the last words that Ruth will speak in this whole story. When it said Ruth told Naomi everything in verse 16 that Boaz had done for her, and she added, "He gave me these 6 scoops of barley and said, don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed." We won't hear from Ruth again in the rest of the story. We'll hear about Ruth, but we won't hear from Ruth in the rest of the story. Well, we have what is certain and what is uncertain staring us in the face as we enter into chapter 4. The certainty was that Ruth would shortly have a husband. The uncertainty was whether she would be married to Boaz or this other man. But the big difference with the uncertainty of Ruth's Redeemer and our Redeemer, Jesus Christ, is this. When it comes to our way to God, there is only one kinsman Redeemer. There is only one Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no other man, as in this story, there's another man. We have to resolve that, but with Jesus Christ, there is no other man, there is no other way. He is the way, the truth, and the life as our kinsman Redeemer. Okay, come to chapter 4. We're about halfway done. Speed it up just a little bit. Chapter 4. We're going to find out if Boaz's integrity is going to blow this whole thing sky high and ruin this marriage that's made in heaven. There are 3 scenes in chapter 4. I'm just going to give you the titles of these scenes and then we'll go through them quickly. 3 scenes in chapter 4. The first scene is, if the shoe fits, wear it. If the shoe fits, wear it. The second scene is, I, Boaz, take you, Ruth. So you know from that title that things worked out. And the third scene is, unto us a child is born. Okay, if the shoe fits, wear it. If Boaz take, I, Boaz, take you, Ruth, and unto us a child is born. First of all, if the shoe fits, wear it. In verse 1, Boaz predictably went right to work, as Naomi said he would. It says, Boaz went to the town gate, took a seat there, and then we read that just then, city gate. The city gate was a place where people would gather, where business could be transacted, where that was the social media of the day, where people would come and they'd talk and they'd gather and they'd do business, they'd do gossip, they would do all sorts of things. And it also was a place where legal matters would be administered. And so we read that just then this other man came along while Boaz was there. It's another one of those, it just so happened. You know, just by luck, is what the natural mind would say. But this wasn't a chance happening. Remember that Boaz lived in the days of the judges when everyone woke up in the morning and decided to do things in the way that was right in their own eyes. Boaz woke up in the morning and decided to do the thing that was right in God's eyes. He went to the city gate. So there was no luck involved here. By the way, you're having a potluck. I tend to not call them potlucks because I found that potlucks are very well organized. They're intentional. There's nothing just by luck. It wasn't just the lady showed up today and also, oh, you brought some food. I brought some food too. Well, isn't that by luck? We all have food. Let's have a potluck. This is a pot plan meal, okay? And this was no luck that this man came by. It was designed by God. Boaz woke up to do what was right in God's eyes, and he knew he had to go to the city gate, and he had to meet with that man. He probably came through there every day because you went through the city gate in and out of the city to go to the fields and to do business. There's an interesting contrast that can be drawn here between Samson, who lived during the days of the judges, okay? One of the judges woke up early every morning to make decisions that were right in his own eyes. And that got him in a whole lot of trouble in his life because he woke up to do things that were right in his own eyes. And it isn't ironic that his eyes were eventually gouged out by the Philistines. But Boaz woke up every morning asking himself what was right in God's eyes, what were the right things to do as God saw it, and that's why Boaz has to appeal to this nearest relative. The first question that all of us should ask every day when we get up is this: what is the right thing to do in God's eyes today? Not what is the right thing to do in my eyes, but what is the right thing to do in God's eyes today? And then the second question is, what is the right way to do the right thing? Boaz knew that the right thing to do in God's eyes was to allow this opportunity for this other nearest kinsman redeemer for him to buy a piece of property and to take Ruth as his wife. But he also knew he had to do the right thing in the right way. He wasn't going to be able to manipulate and lie to this man. He had to be forthcoming and tell him the entire truth. So in verses 3 and 4 of chapter 4, we read that Boaz is setting out the situation. Boaz said to the family redeemer, "You know Naomi, who came back from Moab. She's selling the land that belonged to our relative Elimelech." Now we find out that Elimelech actually had some land that he left to go to Moab. And he says she's selling the land that belonged to our relative Elimelech, and I thought I should speak to you about it so that you can redeem it if you wish. If you want the land, then buy it here in the presence of these witnesses. But if you don't want it, let me know right away because I'm next in line to redeem it. And the man replied, "All right, I'll redeem it." The land purchase seemed like a good idea to him, knowing that Elimelech had no heirs, and that Naomi was too old to have children. It was a really good business said, this might endanger my own estate. What does he mean by that? Well, he thought that Naomi had no heirs, and he could buy the land and it would be fully his when Naomi passed away. And now all of a sudden, it turns out differently. And perhaps by that he meant that it would endanger his children's inheritance by investing money and property only to lose it on the day when Ruth's first child would claim it legally. And so his other children would not have access to the land. So the other kinsman redeemer took his offer off the table. He said, nope, I'm not going to redeem it. And we're going, whew, okay, things are looking good. Well, we need to hurry on. Verses 9 through 13, just that section, is a section entitled, I Boaz Take You Ruth. And the marriage was now taking place. For Ruth, her redemption was free because Boaz paid the price for the land. And then she also was able to marry Boaz. Her redemption was free, Boaz paid the price. Does that sound familiar? Our redemption from our sins is free. Jesus Christ paid the price. So Boaz is kind of a picture, not a perfect picture, but a good picture of Jesus Christ and what he has done for us. So, Boaz takes Ruth as his wife. We come down to the end of verse 13 of chapter 4, and it says that the Lord enabled her to become pregnant, and she gave birth to a son. Unto us a child is born. She gave birth to a son. Verse 14, the women of the town said to Naomi, praise the Lord who has now provided a redeemer for your family. May this child be famous in Israel. May he restore your youth and care for you in your old age, for he is the son of your daughter-in-law who loves you and has been better to you than seven sons. And Ruth gave birth to a son, and verse 17 says that they named him Obed. And just like Mahlon and Kilian meant sick and tired, and Elimelech meant my God is king, and Ruth, Naomi's name meant pleasant, they have a son, Ruth had, and Boaz have a son named Obed, and his name means one who serves. Obed would have a son named Jesse. And Jesse would have eight sons. And the youngest of those eight sons was named David. And he would become the king of Israel. So Obed, or David's great grandparents were Boaz and Ruth. See how this is all tied together? The book of Ruth begins with a series of tragic deaths, and it ends with a glorious birth. And the story of Ruth shows that God's hands are all over history. Even in unknown places with unknown people at that time, the process of history is not haphazard. No matter how much we think it may be, God's hands, even today, are all over history. There is a purpose in it all, and God is fulfilling his purpose. He created Ruth on purpose, for a purpose, just like he's created you on purpose, for a purpose. Well, we read at the end of chapter 4, history that we had just been covering the last number of weeks is included here in Matthew chapter 1. If it weren't for Ruth, we wouldn't have Jesus. It's all in God's plan. The bottom line is, God rewards the faithfulness of ordinary people to do great things that transcend their lifetimes. Ruth said, why have I found such favor? I don't deserve it. I don't deserve to be a part of this gleaning crew here. We need to ask the questions ourselves, as we did a number of weeks ago. Why have we found such favor with Christ, with our kinsman redeemer? We don't deserve it. We don't deserve to be forgiven. We don't deserve to be accepted by God. I don't deserve to be a part of the family and a part of the people of God. So why have I found such favor? And the answer is, our only Redeemer, our one and only Redeemer, God's one and only Son, Jesus Christ, died so that we might live. You might be familiar with the song, My Jesus, I Love Thee. Some of the lines in there go like this. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. Boaz purchased Ruth's pardon to be a part of the family of God. Jesus Christ purchased our pardon so we might become a part of the family of God. The question I leave you with today is, have you placed yourself at the feet of the Lord of the harvest? Has Ruth placed herself at the feet of the Lord of the harvest? Not the Lord of the harvest, meaning Jesus, but Boaz, who was the Lord of his harvest. She placed herself humbly at his feet and said, cover me with your wings. Have you placed yourself at the feet of the Lord of the harvest and asked him to cover you with his wings of salvation? Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you today and thank you for this story of Ruth, which is just in itself a great story. But it's your story. It's what we call history, or his story, the story of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, help us to understand that we too are created on purpose, for a purpose that may transcend our